first meeting of the of the online culture seminar for the fall semester. Our first speaker of this seminar and today is Olbay Mirbayev, who will talk about some combinatorial questions of differential polynomial algebras. Olbay, please.
Okay. Thank you very much. I am very, very thankful to the organizers of this seminar, especially Gleb Pogodin, for giving me this opportunity to talk about this seminar. In fact, we are doing some related things with differential algebra, so I am glad to be heard with differential algebra specialists. So there are some problems we cannot solve in this area. So I wanted to tell about them. Just a minute. Okay, first I will start with the ideal membership problem. It is a well-known problem in polynomial algebras. So it is Pn is a polynomial algebra in n variables over a constructive field K. So the ideal membership is decidable for Pn. It means that there exists an effective algorithm that for any finite sequence of elements f1, f2, fn from n determines if f belongs to the ideal generated by elements f1, f2, fn or not. So in other words, it's called the what problem for the quotient algebra is decidable. In classical algebra, it's called what problem, but in algorithmic theory, I saw that it's called the ideal membership problem. So the solution is based on the Grobner basis method by Buchberger. And I don't want to mention all the results about what problem in classical algebra case. They are all undecidable almost. So, but this one is the interesting one related algebras. So William Magnus proved in 1930 that the odd problem for one related groups is decidable. And he also proved the following problem. If a group G is given, generated by elements x1, xn, and by one defining relation r equal to one. So it is, and this defining relation r, the word r, cannot be written without xn. Then in this group, x1, x2, xn minus one is the basis for a free subgroup of G. So this one in algebra, it's often studied in this way, and it's called always Freiheitssatz theorem. Now, after that, these results were proved for Lie algebras. Anatoly Shershov proved in 1962 that exact analog of these results for Lie algebras. So the word problem for one related Lie algebras is decidable, and the Freiheitssatz is true for Lie algebras. And I want to mention also a case of associative algebras. It's a classical case. So Makar-Limanov in 1985 proved the Freiheitssatz is true for associative algebras of characteristic zero. In characteristic P, this question is still open. The most interesting question here is the following problem. Is the word problem for one related associative algebras decidable? I forgot to mention here, it is, I can mention it now. So in fact, it is solved for groups, but for semi-groups with one defining relation, it's also still open, in fact. It's a very difficult problem. Now, I want to mention second algorithmic problem. We study also the subalgebra membership problem. So it means the following. The subalgebra membership problem for PN polynomial algebra in n variables is also algorithmically decidable. That means there exists an effective algorithm that for any finite sequence elements F, F1, Fm determines whether F belongs to the subalgebra generated by F1, F2, Fm or not. So it is subalgebra membership problem for polynomial algebras. It was solved also by Grobner methods, by Shannon Swidler in 1988. And in characteristic zero, it is a little bit complicated method in that case, but it was solved also by Noskov in characteristic zero using Galois theory, transcendence elements and so on. Now, one more problem in this area, related to free algebras, algebraic dependency. So it is a finite algebraic dependency of a finite system of elements F1, F2, Fm is algorithmically recognizable. So there is an algorithm that recognizes if they are algebraically dependent or not. In fact, it is this fact can be formulated easier to solve. So it's just sufficient to calculate the rank of a matrix in hierarchy zero. So the set of elements F1, F2, Fm of the polynomial algebra over hierarchy zero is algebraically dependent if and only if the rank of the Jacobian matrix. Jacobian matrix is constituted in this way. So the rank of this matrix is less than M. So it can be easily calculated in the polynomial algebra. It can be decided in this way. But it also a general algorithm was given by Shannon Swidler also. Okay, I want to mention here some results in classical algebra case for subalgebra membership problem. Subalgebra membership problem, so it's in fact, in the case of free groups, the word problem is the ideal membership problem is undecidable, but subalgebra membership problem is decidable in fact. And for free algebras is also decidable. And these free Lie superalgebras, the analogous of superanalogous of Lie algebras, and the same results are true, in fact. So I want to define here free system of elements. This is the analog of algebraic dependency. A system of elements F1, F2 of a group G is called free if it is the basis of a free subgroup of G. So it generates if it generates the free subgroup, then its set is called free system, or group algebraically independent, which we can see. Okay, this can be defined in every variety of algebras, for Lie algebras and for Lie superalgebras, for associative algebras. Freeness of a finite system of elements is algorithmically recognizable also for free groups, for free algebras and the free algebras. But it is different in the case of associative algebras, for example. So for free associative algebras, the subalgebra membership problem is undecidable. It is also undecidable for solvable algebras of solvable lengths greater or equal than three. And the same result true for free solvable groups of lengths of solvable lengths greater or equal than three. So in those free algebras, the subalgebra membership problem is undecidable. And associative algebras are specific in this case. The freeness of a finite system of elements of free associative algebras is algorithmically unrecognizable. This is the only result proved to be negative only for free associative algebras. As I mentioned before, it is solvable, it is decidable for Lie algebras, for groups, and so on. So here in deciding this, we interpret Minsky machines, so-called, and it's more convenient machines than Turing machines and so on. And also to solve subalgebra membership problem, we can interpret the Ward problem, undecidable to the Ward problem too. Now, differential algebras, because you are here all differential, so it's specialists on differential algebras, I think I can skip this one, just notations here. So it is a basic sort of derivations, delta 1, delta m, and R is called differential ring. If there are such a number of derivations of this algebra, and the commuting set of derivations. So the example is polynomial algebra in n variables with partial derivatives standard. If delta consists of only one derivation, then differential rings are called ordinary. And in this case, we can use notation. So it's the derivative of A, it is A delta is equal to A prime or A2 prime and so on. If delta consists at least of two elements, then it's called a partial differential. This was ordinary partial are important to me in this talk. So I mentioned them. Now, I call this thing in enveloping algebras. So it is delta one, delta one derivatives. And we compose a commutative monoid from this delta one, delta m. So it is theta I denoted here. Elements of theta, all derivatives, in fact, of this form. Then, if R is a differential ring, then RE denote free left R module, which bases this one. So it means every element of U of RE can be written in the following form. U is equal to RE from differential algebra, and here theta is derivative. Okay, for example, this derivation. And we can turn this set into a ring by defining multiplication theta I, R is equal to R theta of theta I of R. So it is Ore extension. It's called this algebra I will call RA, the universal enveloping algebra. So it is, there is a notion of universal multiplicative enveloping algebra in classical algebra. So it is not usual enveloping algebra, but it plays the same role as universal algebra in many cases. So it is, it's called universal multiplicative enveloping algebra. It is defined easily if every R module, in fact. So it is a module over this RE. Now, if R is a differential ring, and let R be a differential ring, and the X be an independent differential variable, I said. So it's, if it is, if it consists of only one derivative, then the differential polynomial Rx is a polynomial algebra in the variables X, X prime, and so on. You can see the independent, as independent commutative variables, and the differential derivation extended in this way. So it is differential polynomial algebra in one variable. If it is not delta contains more elements, then we consider the set of all elements X theta for all theta from theta, capital theta. And then this is a polynomial algebra. R is a polynomial algebra on this set. So the derivatives extended in this way. Rx in this case calls the ring of differential polynomials in one variable X over R. Now by adjoining more variables, you can attain differential ring over R in the variables X1, X2, and so on, Xn. So just mentioned to here, so it is M is the free commutative monoid generated by all elements Xi theta. Then elements of macroeuclidean monomials and every element A can be uniquely written in the form RMM. So it's monoids form a basis of this differential algebra. Now, differentially closed ideal. So it is in associated commutative algebra called Noetherian if it satisfies the ascending chain of conditions on ideals or equivalent to every ideal of R is finite generated. Hilbert's Bayes theorem says if R is Noetherian ring with unity, then so is Rx. So this implies that every finitely generated associative or and commutative algebra over a field is Noetherian. In the case of differential algebras, so it is we have to consider because it is theta included into the signature of this set of algebras. So we have to consider differentially closed ideals. And an analog of this theorem, the Hilbert theorem, is not true for differential ideals. So it is an example in the case of polynomial algebra with one variable. You can consider this differential ideal. So then it is not finitely generated. It's I forgot someone's result. It was proved by someone. Now, in this case, in the case of differential algebra, it's convenient to consider radically closed differential ideals. An ideal R is called radically closed if An contained in I for some, and then A is also contained in I. So an ideal is of a differential is called a radical differential ideal if it's radical and the differential closed. So it is called differential ring is called the radical notarian. If it satisfies the ascending chain condition on the radical differential ideals, or equivalently, every radical differential ideal of R is finitely generated as a radical differential ideal. The famous Rauden-Bosch Bayes theorem, an analog of Hilbert's theorem, says if R is a radical Noetherian differential ring with unity containing Q, then so is Rx. This is the exact analog of this Hilbert theorem. So corollary, every finitely generated differential algebra over a field of characteristic zero is radically Noetherian. Then, now the most interesting corollary of this that Rauden-Bosch theorem, in fact, so is that the ideal membership problem is decidable for radical differential ideals in characteristic zero. This problem was started by Reed, and then Kolchin, then at the end of the Seidenberg finishes this result in a good form. So there are also differential standard basis as an analog of Gröbner basis, and algorithmic problems studied by the following authors. So it is, I listed here some authors, maybe I don't know all of them, but I looked at least their works, I'm familiar with their books, maybe the others I don't know, I'm sorry. When I said that this problem is a differential ideal membership problem algorithmically decidable, I said that this one is a Reed's problem, but people said, no, it is not called Reed's problem. But in the book, in 1915's book of Reed, at the end, you can find he formulated this question. So I call this Reed's problem. There is another, as I understand, there is another more famous Reed's problem. Okay. Is the differential ideal membership problem, so without radical closedness, algorithmically decidable? So the most interesting thing, in fact, here is what problem decided for one related differential algebras. In many works devoted to what problem, in fact, to ideal membership problem. In this case, especially it was studied this case, one related differential algebra case. So it's a differential ideal generated by only one element. So it is still, this problem is still not known, in fact, not solved yet. Okay, well, the Freiheitssatz, it is natural to ask about Freiheitssatz. Freiheitssatz is true for differential algebras of characteristic zero. I think it is known and declared this result, but Makar Limanov, for example, he is a specialist on Freiheitssatz. He always uses this type of singles. So if he didn't formulate it, it's okay then. It's true that the Freiheitssatz is true for differential algebra is characteristic zero. As I said in my talk, it is important the difference between ordinary and partial differential algebras, because for partial algebras, I can solve many singles negatively. So I proved in 2016 that the ideal membership problem for differential polynomial algebras with at least two basic derivations is algorithmically undecidable. And I also proved that subalgebra membership problem for differential polynomial algebras with at least two basic derivations is algorithmically undecidable. So it is based on my old methods, so it's here Minsky machines without cycles, I interpreted the, and to solve B, to prove B, I interpreted the what problem already. So the Ritz problem about the what problem for differential polynomial algebras is still not known for ordinary differential algebras. It is very interesting problem, in fact. For polynomial algebras, we can solve. If there are two derivations, it is undecidable, but it is between them with one differential operator. So it's ordinary differential algebras. It's a very interesting problem. And I don't know, it is all methods. What I know, it doesn't work in this case. It is very interesting to us because we study also Novikov algebras. It is closely related to Novikov algebras, this problem. So this problem is still open, in fact. Now, differential algebraic dependence. Here I didn't define, in that case I defined, as I remember this, for polynomial algebras, it is easy to define partial derivatives, right? So it is called, in general case, it's called Fox derivatives. Fox derivatives can be defined for every free algebra. If you consider differential polynomial algebras free algebras, then you can define here Fox derivatives, and you can get for any element f vector, which consists of the components of Fox derivatives. Okay, then in these cases, these coefficients belong to the enveloping algebra of Dn. For that reason, I defined the enveloping algebra. So it is this element df dx1, for example, it is an element from the enveloping algebra. So it's of the enveloping algebra. In the case of differential algebras, enveloping algebras satisfy Auré condition. So it is, can be embedded into the division ring, into Golgi division ring. Okay, now what we proved about differential algebraic dependence. Elements F1, F1, F2, Fn algebraically dependent if and only if these rows, these rows df1, df2, dfm are left dependent over enveloping algebra. So in this case, as a corollary, we can decide if a finite system of elements are algebraically dependent or not. There is an algorithm solving linear equations, in some cases, good case, for algebra DNA. It is a ring of, division ring of DN. Okay, in this case, so differential algebraic dependency of a finite number of elements algorithmically recognizable. Now, I want to talk about something about automorphisms, but there are no essential results, but there are some problems. So I want to formulate. First, I want to explain this a little bit. Automorphisms of polynomial algebras in two variables, they are called, here is denoted X, which sends X to X, and Y to alpha Y plus FX. And the second type of automorphisms, which sends X to beta X plus G of Y and Y to Y. These are, in fact, automorphisms. And these automorphisms are called elementary automorphisms of the polynomial algebra in two variables. In fact, it is easy to understand for three variables too. So elementary automorphisms are those automorphisms which changes only one coordinate, leaving the other coordinates unchanged. So an automorphism is called tame if it is a product of elementary automorphisms. Non-tame automorphisms are called wild. So Jung and van der Kalk proved every automorphism of polynomial algebra in two variables is a product of elementary automorphisms. So in the case of two variables, we have all automorphisms are tame in this case. Now, together with these automorphisms, I have to mention some, if you study automorphisms, then you have to mention some locally nilpotent derivations. A derivation of a polynomial algebra in n variables is called locally nilpotent if for any a from this algebra, there exists a number which depends on A, such that if you differentiate this element M times, you get zero. So what is for this local nilpotent derivations? The problem is that here, if you have any local nilpotent derivation, then exponential of this mapping is well defined at any element because it's local nilpotent. So, and it defines an automorphism of the polynomial algebra. These automorphisms call it exponential automorphisms. Now, derivation examples of local nilpotent derivations is just partial derivation usual by xi. You know it is local nilpotent, right? And there are such triangular derivations. Triangular derivations, so it is if dxi belongs, does not depend xi and depends on the variables xi plus one and xn. So it is easy to check that triangular derivations are also local nilpotent derivations. This is a very wide class of known local nilpotent derivations. So usually first question comes as following, are they triangulable? So it's, if you have any local nilpotent derivations, is it true that this local nilpotent is a triangulable? So what does it mean triangulable? It means following. A derivation is called triangulable if there exists an automorphism phi of the polynomial algebra, such as that if you conjugate that derivation, you get, this is a derivation again, you get a triangular derivation. So if it is conjugate to a triangular derivation, then it's called triangulable. Okay, so of course, the first task here is for local nilpotent derivations was to define if it is triangulable on it. And again, in the case of characteristic zero, and in the case of two variables, it was proven by Rentschler that every local nilpotent derivations of the polynomial algebra in two variables of the characteristic field, they are triangulable. Now, polynomial algebras in three variables. So here is I take partial, it's denoted as one derivation, which sends x to 2y, y to z, z to zero, it is a triangular derivation. This is a local nilpotent derivation, and this element is a constant of this derivation. W y squared minus x, because if you differentiate element as this element, you get zero. Now, if you multiply this delta, this W by delta, you get again derivation. So it means you apply this partial, then multiply by delta. You get again derivation, and this is a local nilpotent derivation again. Chaim and Bass proved that this derivation is not triangulable. So in the case of three variables, there are local nilpotent derivations that are not triangulable. And Chaim and Bass considered this derivation because it was known before. In 1974, Nagata constructed one example, sigma, exponential of this local nilpotent derivation. And it is defined as an automorphism, defined simple automorphism of this form. This is so-called Nagata automorphism. And Nagata conjectured, in fact, this automorphism should be non-tame in the case of three variables. So Martha Smith, for example, proved the Nagata automorphism is stable 10. But what does it mean stable 10? If you add one more variable, t, and extend this variable sending t to t, then this automorphism becomes tame, in fact. So it is called stable tame. In 2001, we proved that the Nagata automorphism is wild in characteristic zero. So in characteristic pair, this question is still open. So this is a situation with derivations and local nilpotent derivations in the case of polynomial algebras. In the case of more variables, three variables, for example, there are no good results, in fact. In the case of free associative algebras in two variables, the same results are true. In fact, it was proved by free associative algebras in two variables. So Makarliman and Chernykevich proved in these years, every automorphism of a free associative algebra in two variables is a product of elementary automorphism. They were so-called David Anik's example. which is also again stable time. This is this automorphism much more easier than even Nagatov's, so it's degree three automorphism in fact. So I proved that in 2004 that this automorphism was also wide in characteristic three, so it cannot be represented as a product of elementary automorphisms. Now, again, it's in the case we have results in the case of partial differential polynomial algebras. So if you have two derivations, delta one, delta two, they commute. So you have two commuting elements. It is very helpful in study of solving negatively of the word problem there and in constructing some examples. So we take this example, W, which is X delta one minus Y delta two. And we consider T derivation, which sends the X to this element and Y to this element. Then it is locally nilpotent derivation. We prove it in this case that T is not triangulable. So in the case of two variables, in fact, we, in the partial, so if there are two derivations, in the case of two variables, you already get non-triangulable derivations, non-triangulable derivations. And we construct here tau exponential derivation for this. So the exponential automorphism of this derivation, and we prove it that this becomes an analog of that Anik automorphism. We prove it that this automorphism is wild. So in fact, automorphisms are not triangulable and there are wild automorphisms if we have two derivations. Now, ordinary differential polynomial algebras in two variables. So I formulate here two conjectures, in fact. I think that every automorphism of an ordinary differential polynomial algebra in two variables is a product of elementary automorphisms. And I also think that all locally nilpotent derivations of an ordinary differential polynomial algebra in two variables over a field of characteristic zero, that is also in characteristic zero, are triangulable, okay? So I cannot solve, I tried in fact, but I cannot solve at the moment these problems. So I want to explain why I cannot solve them. What difficulties are there in differential polynomial algebras in this case? So I want to formulate one more problem here. So in the case of polynomial algebras, usual polynomial algebras Pn, we have the following result. It is easy result. So if two elements F and G of a polynomial algebra Pn are algebraically dependent, then there exists some element C on Pn that Fg are polynomials in one variable, in one general variable C. So in fact, Fg, if they are algebraically dependent, they are polynomials in one variable C. This is a well-known result in this case. So it is, this result is true in the case of associative algebras also. If you have two elements, if they do not generate free associative algebra, so it means associative algebraically dependent, I wrote here, then there exists general element C such that Fg is a polynomial in one variable C. A polynomial is one variable. And the conjecture three. So I want to formulate an analog of this conjecture for differential polynomial algebras. If you have two elements Fg of a differential polynomial algebra in n variables, and suppose that they are differential algebraically dependent, then they exist C such that Fg belongs to the differential algebra generated by this C. So it's the exact analog of this one. So I cannot prove this result. I cannot prove this result. And I want to formulate in this case more understandable question for you. So you know In the case of commutative algebras, it's integrally closedness. The polynomial algebra Pn is integrally closed. That means it's if you take any element in the polynomial, is the quotient algebra of this polynomial algebra, so it is polynomial algebra of rational functions. So if f satisfies an equation of this form, then f is a polynomial. So it is integral, it means the leading coefficient here is equal to one. Otherwise, it's not true, of course. Okay. Now, so how to define integrally closedness in the case of differential polynomial algebras? I noticed this that it was studied, it was studied by Trushin, and Pagudin mentioned it in his work on, he proved an analog of Hilbert's theorem for differential algebras. And so how to, I don't know, in fact, which, but you can take any ordering of in these monomials in one variable, okay? Then you can take, so it's, suppose that some leading coefficient is equal to one. So conjecture is the following. Now, we have differential polynomial algebra in n variables. And suppose you have an element in the quotient field of this algebra. Suppose that this f is the root of some differential polynomial gx from dnx, so we added one variable. And suppose some, with respect to some other ordering, the leading coefficient is equal to one. Then f belongs to dn. So I think it is the easiest question, in fact, what I formulated. Maybe someone knows something, maybe you know how to prove, maybe you know some example, counterexample in this case. So it is a direct question in this case. So f is a polynomial in the quotient algebra, is the root of some differential. We couldn't solve this problem. Makar Liman, my friend, also tried to solve this question, so we couldn't solve it together, in fact. There is some difficulty here. So I wanted to ask you about this question.
I cannot answer this question, but I would like to make a scheduling comment. So we are a bit out of time, so we started a couple of minutes later. So maybe if you could a bit restructure, maybe summarize what you were going to talk in a couple of minutes, and then after breakout rooms we can have a bit more elaborate.
Okay,
discussion.
So I understand here it's prepared. It's already time. So I wanted to talk. Let me talk about this page only. So if you take here, it's a look at this Gelfand-Dorfman construction, I understand. Let D be an ordinary differential algebra. Then D is a Novikov algebra with respect to this product. This product X, Y, is equal to X, Y prime. So it is in fact very closely, this is an easy multiplication. It is closely related to this D, in fact. So it is, we obtain in this way Novikov algebra. Novikov algebra is an algebra which satisfies these two identities, in fact, two identities. It's a non-associative algebra. And later it was proved that every Novikov algebra can be obtained in this way. For some differential algebra. Now, if you consider this in this way, so with respect to commutator in this way, so you get Lie algebra. Okay. So we study this Novikov algebra. They are very closely related to this, and I can say what I formulated questions there for the ordinary differential polynomial algebras. They are all still open for Novikov algebras, in fact. So I'm sorry, I want to finish at this point.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Questions to the speaker? Please just unmute yourself or type in the chat.
So here I see some questions, slide 23.
Yes, so there was a question, I think, about notation, where F lives, but I think the answer is that F lives in the f is a quotient of two differential polynomials on slide 23.
Just a minute. So to slide 23, you mean this one?
Yeah, yeah. So I think John was asking about the conjecture four.
Uh-huh.
So, and the question was there F, what's this Q of Dn? And I think this is a fractional field of Dn.
Yeah, quotient field. Yeah, it's element from the quotient field. So satisfies is the root of some differential polynomial Gx in dx, dnx, so it's here polynomial is one variable. And the sum with leading coefficient one. Leading coefficient, you can choose. I don't know if exactly, we tried. So it's, you have to take some ordering, and the highest one is the leading coefficient, take one.
Yeah, so John writes that this clarifies to him. Thank you.
Okay. Do you know answers to this question?
No, not yet.
Okay.
Okay, so.
Hello.
Yeah.
So in yeah. four, is there any special case that this is proved?
Which do you mean this conjecture four?
Yeah, conjecture four. Is there any special case that this is true already?
Yeah, it is. So. We came to one difficult, I don't remember at the moment, but for this case, it's proved. So we came to some difficult place and we stopped it. Before that, it was solved.
So
those special case I can say, but in general, it's not solved.
No.
So we didn't formulate anything, in fact.
So not even n equals one?
No.
Or m equals one?
No, it is. We don't know.
Okay.
In this case, if you can solve for n equal to one, probably you can solve for any n. I think.
So the property is can be induction, can be inductive.
Which I didn't answer. What is the question?
By what you just commented, you said that if you can solve for n equals one, then you can solve for any n. So I'm just asking.
I think so. I think so. I'm not sure now, but I think so. In fact, it is efficient to solve in. So probably it should work in general. Because I don't know.
Okay.
Okay. I'm sorry. but we couldn't solve for one, n equal to one.
Okay.
Okay, so I suggest we continue breakout rooms now, and then we can have some more technical questions afterwards. So Ronnie will advise us.
All right. Awesome.